If you do the math about the delaying the second dose, to me, it's a risk, but it's a calculated risk that just makes a lot of sense. It's clear that from a public health perspective, the bang for the buck on that second dose is to give it to someone who's not immune and get a 90% chance you protect a second person instead of a couple of digit percent on that first person.
So what information do we have then about how effective the first dose of the vaccine is versus the second? We've heard a lot of different numbers. Can you explain that a little bit?
Yeah, I think it's really, really important to understand the data when we talk about this delayed second dose plan. The two big numbers everyone hears about is the first dose is 50% effective. Oh, no, the first dose is 90% effective. So how can we have such completely disparate numbers? And it's actually very easy to understand. It depends on when you look at the activity of the first dose. If you say, I'm going to consider all cases from the moment you walk out of the vaccine clinic until the second dose, the vaccine is 50% effective in preventing cases between the second you get the first dose and the second you get the second dose. But of course, vaccines don't work instantly. In fact, we normally expect the vaccine to kick in around, let's say, 14 days. And that's just, of course, a rough number. Just like when you train your body to work out, it takes weeks for your body to respond. When vaccines train our immune system, it takes a good 2 weeks for our immune system to pick up. So the 50% number takes into account all those cases that happen before the vaccine has a chance to work. The 90% number is simply the number looking at from day 14 after you get the vaccine until the second dose, whether it's in the Pfizer or the Moderna trial. And that's when we expect the vaccine to be working. And in that period, it was 90% plus effective.
So what do you make of the information that you're hearing out of Israel about the efficacy after a first dose?
So the data that came out of Israel was really, unfortunately, one of those times where the headline has very little to do with what's in the article. So the data that came out of Israel said very simply that if you look at the first 2 weeks after we give the first dose of the vaccine, we're only seeing a 33% efficacy. Well, hold on a second. Those first 2 weeks, I just told you, I don't expect to see any efficacy. And in fact, if you look at the Pfizer trial data, it doesn't work in the first 2 weeks because we wouldn't expect it to. I'm actually over the moon happy if there was a 33% reduction during the period where the vaccine's just ramping up. And in fact, that's exactly what the ministry is saying. It's not what happens in the first 14 days. It's what happens after 14 days, when we expect that this thing is actually trained our immune system to have a response.
So what exactly happens in the body after a first dose? And then what happens after the second?
So the first dose gives your body and its immune system the core instructions of, hey, this is a bad thing. You better wake up. You better make antibodies, you better rev up your immune cells and be ready if you see this thing because it's a bad thing and it may be coming your way. And if you look at the immune response, the initial one causes a very robust usually, but not perfect immune response to whatever this challenge is, in this case, the virus. The second dose kind of locks it in, and it locks it in two ways. Number one, it improves the quality of the response. So if you will, instead of just a all hands on deck, get the immune system up and running, it starts to train specialists who are actually specifically designed and really good at tackling just that particular virus. And the other thing it does is it locks in the long-term response. So while your first dose may give you protection that lasts 3 months, 6 months, 9 months, maybe even a year, we don't know. There's no question that adding a second dose, a booster dose, will prolong that immune response and lock it in longer term. So that's why when we talk about delaying the second dose, we always talk about delaying it. We're not talking about taking it away. It is a critical part of the vaccine regimen. But if you stop and think about it, there aren't many vaccines where you get your booster at day 21. And in fact, we know the timing of the booster in most vaccines is not actually critical, so long as you get it in a reasonable time frame. And that's the calculated risk that the government is taking here. Are we risking the longer term effects? I don't think we're risking whether it's going to work or not. I just think we have to be careful that we monitor how fast immunity declines with this and that our 90 days or our 42 days or whatever that magic time we check is still in the safe period. Basic vaccinology tells us it should be just fine, but of course we have to be vigilant and watch for it.
What do you see as the key here to really getting the pandemic under control? Is it having a single dose vaccine? Is it having a portfolio of vaccines like the government is hoping to have?
So I think that every arrow we have in our quiver from the point of view of vaccines is a huge advantage, because not every vaccine is the perfect solution for everyone. Obviously, a single dose vaccine has some huge advantages. I wouldn't have to have this interview with you about one dose versus delaying second dose if there's no second dose. But we need to see the data. You know, are we going to be compromising the overall efficacy of the vaccine in favor of a one dose? Is it as good as the Pfizer and Moderna? Maybe it's even better. I don't know, but we really need to see the data. There's no question, however, the more vaccines we have, the more companies making them, the more supplies that get to Quebec, the better off we're going to be and the faster we can turn this epidemic around and get back to what will be our new normal.